Hello friends, welcome to Daily Editorial Enrichment Program brought to you by La Excellence R&D team. Today we'll discuss important articles that has been appeared in the newspaper The Hindu dated 16th December 2019. In this page, we have provided the index with the article name with respect to its page number, and the first article is The Distinct Cry of an Imperial Frontier. This article is based on the Citizenship Amendment Act 2019 and it's in the page number 10. And then the second article is Spot the Difference Between Sign and the Symbol, and this is in the page number 10, and this article is related to recent statement by Ministry of External Affairs saying that they are going to change the symbol in the passport. And the third article is Maternity Scheme Exclusionary, Need Benefits for All, it's in the page number 5. This article is based on the Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. Then the fourth article is No Deal as Longest Climate Talks End, this is about COP25. Then Please in Supreme Court Speak of Past Judgments, this is in relation to Citizenship Amendment Act 2019 again. Then 6th and 7th article are Only 32% of rape cases ended in conviction in 2017 and Long Wait for Justice for Rape Survivors in Kerala. These articles are related to the delay in justice to rape victims. And then we shall discuss previously given prelims practice questions. And then today also I'll provide two questions for practice. Moving on to the first article, in the page number 10, we have The Distinct Cry of an Imperial Frontier. The rest of India must recognize the concerns of the Northeast in what it sees in the Citizenship Amendment Act. This is a subheading, and this topic can be linked to the syllabus GS2, that is Government Policies and Interventions for Development in Various Sectors and Issues Arising Out of the Design and Implementation. We know that the new amendment to the Citizenship Act of 1955 aims to provide Indian citizenship to Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhist, Jain, Parsi and Christian refugees from Afghanistan, Bangladesh and Pakistan. And then a person belonging to any of these faiths who entered India on or before December 31, 2014 and have lived in the country for 6 years, then he can apply for the Indian citizenship. Though this provision covers refugees from three nations, the people in the Northeast fear that it will primarily benefit the illegal Bengali Hindu migrants from Bangladesh and who have settled in large numbers across this region. And now, presently, taking note of the protest, the revised version of the amendment has exempted certain areas in the region, such as Arunachal Pradesh, Nagaland, Mizoram, Manipur, and almost the whole of Meghalaya and parts of Assam and Tripura. While these exemptions have calmed down the other areas of the Northeast, but still massive protests are going on in Assam, particularly in the Brahmaputra Valley and in Tripura also. And coming to reasons, the Assamese have not forgotten how British administration imposed Bangla as a state language between 1826 and 1872. Not only this, the linguistic gate of the census 2011 has also widened the already existing fault lines between the Assamese and Bengalis. And according to this survey, according to the census 2011, the percentage of people speaking Assamese decreased from 58% in 1991 to 48% in 2011, while Bengali speakers in the state went up from 22% to 30% in the same period. So, for these reasons, the Assamese fear that if Bengali Hindus and Bengali Muslims join hands, Bengal speakers will easily outnumber these Assamese speaking people in the state, and as it has happened in the Tripura also, where Bengali Hindu immigrants from East Bengal now dominate the political power, pushing the original tribals to the margin. Talking about the languages, going by the UNESCO's definition of endangered languages, more than 200 languages spoken in the Northeast, with the exception of Assamese and Bengali, are in the vulnerable category. And according to the census 2011, there are about 15 million Assamese speakers in Assam. It is the language of the majority in the state. But if they are compared to the region of Bangladesh, Bengal and Assam, then this Assamese speaking population in Assam is a tiny minority when it is compared. And then coming to Bengali speakers, Bengali speakers in Assam total about 9 million according to the census 2011. However, neighboring Bangladesh alone has 164 million speakers of the same language. So, if you see the numbers, it is clear that Bangladesh has more Bengali speakers. So, this is the main fear in Assam of being overwhelmed by an unceasing influx of people from Bangladesh. And then, author says, this is a peculiar situation often described as a majority with a minority complex. Moving further, Bertil Linter, a Swiss journalist, in a recent interview has said that Rohingya crisis is nowhere near the popularly projected binary of Muslim versus Buddhist. And here, the ethnic Rakhines, who are original to that place, they number about 2 million in the Rakhine state. And the journalist says that they are the ones who are feeling the pressure of a continuing population influx from Bangladesh, that is Rohingya Muslims, that is expanding the Rohingya population. Then the Myanmar government favored the Rakhines, that is ethnic Rakhines, it is obvious, but it may be noted that here crisis was precipitated only after the militant organization, that is Arakan Rohingya Salvation Army, made a coordinated attack on 30 Myanmar police camps in August 2017. And this is the incident that prompted the Myanmar government to begin the brutal ethnic cleansing campaign, that is wiping out the Rohingya Muslims out of Myanmar. And then the presence of 7 lakh Rohingya refugees in Bangladesh, which is close to the Chittagong Hill tract, is also making a small ethnic Buddhist communities such as Chakmas and Marmas uneasy, because they're also feeling the marginalization, because refugees are resettling among themselves. So, making Buddhist community a marginalized community in their own areas. Then, the author talks about the language and survival and how it is related to the migration. The author says that a closer look at the UNESCO's classification of endangered languages will illuminate us the why Northeast people are opposing the Citizenship Amendment Act. Then, a language is said to be vulnerable if it has got the small size of the number of speakers, and it becomes more vulnerable if the language is spoken only in certain domain. For instance, only it is spoken at home and but not at schools and offices, etc. And it becomes definitely endangered if parents speak the language and children only know the language but do not speak it as a mother tongue. And then it becomes critically endangered if the grandparents' generation speak the language and the parents know it but they do not use it, and children do not know any more of it, and then this is said to be critically endangered. And coming to extinct languages, there are the languages which no longer have any speakers. In the UNESCO's list, there are several languages from the Northeast which have already gone into the extinct list. And then, according to the Ganeshan Devi, who is a cultural activist and the man behind the People's Linguistic Survey of India campaign, has said it in an interview that if a language dies, a worldview dies with it. And under these circumstances, the response of the Northeast to the Citizenship Amendment Act is not merely a tribal prejudice, but it is a desperate struggle for survival. Then, the ethnic and cultural diversity of the Northeast shows that migrants and their integration have always been a part of the historical reality of the region. And if you observe, large-scale and rapid influxes are the main problem here. Then, the author talks about the bitter politics of the Assam and the Assam's history. To start with, in 1819, the Burmese ruler King Begida, whose army invaded and occupied Assam and Manipur. Then, British intervened this and took over the Assam, which then it was virtually the entire Northeast with the exception of Tripura and Manipur, and formally annexed it in 1826 after the signing of the treaty called Treaty of Endabo. And according to this treaty, Assam was made a part of Bengal province. And then Assam, under the British colonial administration, experienced a migration of educated Hindu Bengalis from the neighboring Sylhet area to fill the colonial bureaucracy and carry forward the colonial project. And it is from this position that the power of the Hindu Bengalis grew, and they dominated the Assam's political as well as cultural spheres. And at one point, even having Bengali declared as the official language of Assam, and this provoked a reaction from the Assamese middle class people. Then in 1874, Assam was separated from the Bengal area and made a separate chief commissioner's province. And then in 1912, the Muslim majority area Sylhet became part of Assam, and then Assamese leadership refused this as Assam would then become a Bengali majority. So Sylhet had to face a referendum separately, and by a thin Muslim majority was awarded to Bangladesh then. So for these reasons, the author says the current migration issue is also a consequence of this bitter politics of the past. And then here nobody is perfectly innocent or guilty in this drama, and the way forward has to be on the path of truth and reconciliation that Nelson Mandela has suggested. Then, moving on to the next article, in the page number 10, we have spot the difference between sign and symbol. The lotus and the palm are not just political marks, just as the lion and the wheel are not just Buddhist representations. This is the subheading, and this topic can be linked to the syllabus GS1, that is Indian culture, salient aspects of art forms, literature and architecture from ancient to modern times. Recently, the Ministry of External Affairs has said that the symbol of lotus has been included in new passports as an additional security measure, and it said that lotus was chosen because it is India's national flower. And the Ministry of External Affairs has also stated that there are other national symbols which would be used on rotational basis, and this month it is lotus, and in the next month it will be some other national symbol which are connected with India. Moving further, in this article the author states that a sign has a singular meaning and a symbol has multiple meanings, shifting with context. For example, the red color is a stop sign in traffic, but a fertility symbol in Hinduism, and in China it is the indicative of the devil and Santa Claus in Christianity. And then talking about the symbol's usage in ancient history, he says Ashoka's India was very different from India under the British Raj. Ashoka lived in times when Buddha's body was never shown in art form, but was represented as a lion or even as a wheel. Then author asks, this image on the Ashoka's pillar, that is lion or the wheel, represents the Buddha itself, or this symbol could then be constructed as religious or it was imperial. Then moving further, he asks, either way, why was it suitable for a secular republic like the symbols of wheel and lion on the Ashoka's pillar? Then talking about the colonial contest, Edwin Arnold, who wrote the book The Light of Asia and the song Celestial that introduced the word about Krishna and Buddha to many Indians studying abroad, including Ambedkar, Gandhi and Nehru, to both Buddha and Krishna. And here, the non-violent Buddha was found to be more appealing than the complex theology of Krishna, who seemed to support the war. This was the time when Indians were rediscovering India and also the Hinduism. And in 20th century, Buddhism was very glamorous, and Nehru and Gandhi admired the philosophies of Buddha, and even Ambedkar converted into Buddhism, finding it more egalitarian, rational and revolutionary. And then author says that 70 years ago, no one saw the lion or the wheel as a symbol of imperial power, and the lion being the alpha predator and the wheel indicating the sun, with the king's power located in the center and the king's authority stretching out like spokes of the wheel to the boundaries. But these symbols not only related to Buddhism, the lion is also a Jain symbol of Mahavira, a contemporary of the Buddha, and the wheel is also a Jain symbol of time and space as well as kingship, found atop every Jain mandir. And if we see Puranic and Vedantic themes, the great value is also placed on Lakshmi, who is the goddess of the wealth, and her symbol is lotus. Lakshmi is one of the earliest goddesses to be carved in India, first in Buddhist shrines, also appearing in dreams of Jain mothers and being invoked in Vedic mantras. So, author says that lotus is not just a BJP symbol, just as the lion and the wheel are not just Buddhist symbol. And then he says the palm is also not just a Congress symbol, it is a gesture indicating protection, that is Abhaya Mudra, which is common to Buddhists, Jains and Hindus. And he says it indicates a common emoji indicating stop or face palm. So, the summary of the article is that the author is saying we cannot relate one particular sign or symbol to any particular religion or sect or any political parties. Then, moving on to the next article, in the page number 5, we have maternity scheme exclusionary, need, benefits for all. Several clauses and lengthy documentation excludes single women and young brides, says activists. This is a subheading. And this topic can be linked to the syllabus GS2, that is Government Policies and Intervention for Development, and also to the other topic, Welfare Schemes for Vulnerable Sections of the Population by the Center and States and the Performance of these Schemes. Before getting into the newspaper article, first let us understand some basics about Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. Scheme was launched in 2016 as a flagship maternity benefits program of the Government of India. Earlier, it was known as the Indira Gandhi Matritva Sahayoga Yojana and is run under the aegis of the Ministry of Women and Child Development. And this scheme is a conditional cash transfer scheme for pregnant and lactating women. And it provides a partial wage compensation to women for wage loss during the childbirth and childcare, and to provide conditions for safe delivery and good nutrition and feeding practices. they receive a cash benefit of ₹5,000 in 3 installments on fulfilling the respective conditionality, that is early registration of pregnancy, antenatal checkup and registration of the birth of the child, and completion of first cycle of vaccination for the first living child of the family. The eligible beneficiaries also receive a cash incentive under the Janani Suraksha Yojana. Thus, on an average, a woman gets ₹6,000. Then, this scheme is a centrally sponsored scheme, that is under which cost-sharing ratio between the center and the states and the union territories with legislature is 60-40, while for northeastern states and 3 Himalayan states, it is 90-10. And then, it is 100% central assistance for union territories without legislature. Coming to the objectives of this scheme, it provides cash compensation against wage loss so that the mother can take adequate rest before and after the birth of the first living child. Then it promotes good nutrition and feeding practices to reduce infant mortality and also the malnutrition. Then it would also promote healthier behavior among pregnant and lactating mothers. And then it promotes the use of health services and institutional care to reduce the risk of the disease. And then beneficiaries includes pregnant or lactating mothers except those who are employed with the central government public sector units or state governments or those who receive similar benefits from similar laws for the time being. And the other condition for the beneficiary is that women whose pregnancies commenced after January 1st, 2007 and that should be their first child in the family. Then they will receive the benefits under this scheme. As I said, this scheme provides ₹6,000 in 2 installments based on the fulfillment of the conditions. Like the first installment of ₹3,000 is released on registration of pregnancy within the first 4 months at an Anganwadi center or an healthcare facility. Then they should undergo at least 1 parental checkup along with taking up iron supplements and TT vaccine by the mother. And then at least 1 counseling session must be attended by the mother at an Anganwadi center or healthcare facility. Then in the second installment, they will provide ₹3,000 for registration of birth, immunization of the child with a BCG and oral polio vaccine at birth. And then the scheme asks the mother to breastfeed for the first 6 months and give the child complementary food after that. And then they vaccinate the child with a DPT and other polio vaccines and attend 2 counseling sessions when the child is between 3 to 6 months old. This newspaper article talks about the issues involved in implementation of the Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. First point is, the scheme is limited only for the firstborn. But limiting this scheme to only for the first live birth excludes the majority of pregnant women in the country. On an average, 43% of the children born every year in India are firstborns, says the sample registration system 2014. And it is undertaken by the Office of the Registrar General and Census Commissioner of India. And this means that remaining 57% would be out of the purview of the scheme. And it is very strange that the government doesn't care for the ensuring nutrition of the second or the third child. And this firstborn norm also means that states with high fertility rates would face greater exclusion. For example, states like Bihar and Uttar Pradesh, which are underdeveloped, malnourished and poor, they have fertility rates of 3.4 and 2.7 respectively, and these states have not benefited much from the Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. And in Uttar Pradesh, not a single woman had received the money under Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana in Uttar Pradesh till August 26, 2018 as per the RTI reply. And also the fertility rate in rural India is 2.5, while the figure for urban India is 1.8, according to the sample registration survey 2015. Therefore, this scheme will hurt women in rural areas more, and also as a result, the women in rural area will face greater exclusion. And other issues include other related problems. For instance, rejecting the payments due to mismatch, say in the spelling of the beneficiary's name or between a person's Aadhaar card and the bank account. Other than this, they face the difficulties because the address on their Aadhaar card was that of their parents' home and not of their in-laws' house. So, this condition often results in the newlyweds being either left out or forced to go from door to door when pregnant women needing rest and care. And the requirements to produce the husband's Aadhaar card results in excluding women who may be living with men they are not married to, and also single mothers will be excluded from this scheme. And the application form is about 32 pages, a sleeve of documents such as mother-child protection card, Aadhaar card, husband's Aadhaar card and bank passbook aside from linking their bank accounts with other. And then the other condition is that applicant has to be at least 19 years old, and also it will leave out the younger brides who hesitate in getting their marriages registered, as the legal age of marriage is being 18 years in India. So in this article, the activists urge for the need for reviewing the scheme and making it universal by removing all these restrictions on the number of children, as well as including all women, whether they are in the formal or informal sector or engaged in paid or unpaid work, or the sum promised should also be at least on par with the minimum wages for women in self-employment, unpaid work, or working for less than minimum wages. Then moving on to the next article, in the page number 1, we have no deal as longest climate talks ends. This topic can be linked to the syllabus GS3, that is conservation, environmental pollution and degradation, and environmental impact assessment. The Conference of the Parties, that is COP, is the supreme decision-making body of the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Its 195 member countries met annually for 2 weeks to tackle the challenge of climate change and supervise the implementation of the agreed measures. 25th edition of the summit took place, and the slogan was Time to Act, a call to all countries to scale up their commitments to fighting climate change. But this time, in the summit, the countries failed to agree on many of the hoped for outcomes, including rules to set up a global carbon trading system and a system to channel new finance to countries facing the impacts of climate change. Back in 2015, countries agreed in Paris to revisit their climate pledges by 2020, but many countries were pushing this year for a clear call for countries to submit more ambitious climate pledges next year. And this is seen as a key means of ensuring countries to put a more focus on improving their current pledges, as well as empowering civil society to hold them to account. But countries such as China and Brazil oppose placing any obligation on countries to submit enhanced pledges, and countries such as China and India made it clear that they would not support strong language on raising ambition without a similar call for rich countries to provide the finance and support promised to the developing countries. And they called for the creation of a work program to close the gap of commitments made by rich countries before 2020. But the European Union opposed this, saying that focus needs to be on future ambition under the Paris Agreement, which appeals to all countries. Then, a headline outcome of the talks was supposed to be a collection of new rules governing the new global carbon market. This carbon market was established by the Paris Agreement, and setting up its rule is the main remaining part of the so-called Paris rulebook. The nitty-gritty details of how the Paris deal will work in practice. According to a planned timetable, countries should have agreed on these rules last year only. But the issue was pushed to this year's talks. And then at COP25, with tensions breaking out yet again on multiple parts of the rules, no outcome was agreed. Then, with so little agreed at this year's conference at COP25, the stakes will now be even higher for the next COP26 talks, that is going to be held in Glasgow. Then, moving on to the next article, in the page number 13, we have Pleas in Supreme Court Speak of Past Judgments. Religious classification should be based on intelligible differentia, they say. This is the subheading, and this topic can be linked to the syllabus GS2, that is structure, organization and functioning of the executive and the judiciary. We know that Citizenship Amendment Act 2019 has been passed both in Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha, and now the dozen or so petitions have been filed against the Citizenship Amendment Act 2019, which traces a series of Supreme Court judgments in which the court stood up for the dignity of the individual against the tyranny of the majority. For example, in cases like decriminalization of homosexuality, that is striking down the section 377, and also striking down the triple talaq, holds that state cannot discriminate on the basis of an intrinsic and core identity of an individual. And now when it comes to the CAA, that is Citizenship Amendment Act 2019, being Muslim is part of a person's core identity and dignity, and now it cannot be the basis for discrimination for granting the citizenship. And then the Constitution Bench judgment in the petition filed by the Delhi government, that is in the state NCT of Delhi versus Union of India case, which was related to Lieutenant Governor of Delhi and his powers, the court said that it should follow the constitutional morality to check the state power and the tyranny of the majority. And as I said, in the Navjit Singh Jowar case, that is decriminalization of the homosexuality, that is striking down section 377. In this case, the court upheld the concept of identity with dignity. And then it reminded that religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth were intrinsic and core elements of an individual's identity under Article 15. If at all the state ventures to classify people on the basis of religion, then it should be reasonable, based on intelligible differentia, and have a rational basis with the objectives sought to be achieved by the law. But this amendment classify illegal migrants from Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh as those who are Hindu, Sikh, Buddhist, Jain, Parsi or Christian on one side, and those who are Muslim on the other, and the amendments provide benefits to illegal migrants who practice any of the six ways and excludes Muslim. And the constitution bench in S.R. Bommai case has said that the state cannot favor any particular religion, and it is the government's duty to accord equal treatment to members of all the faiths. While striking down the triple talaq, Supreme Court in Shaira Bano case held that a legislation which is manifestly arbitrary, capricious, irrational, excessive or disproportionate should be struck down. Then, moving on to the next article, in the page number 4, we have only 32% of rape cases ended in conviction in 2017. Witnesses turning hostile during trial affect the conviction rate, says the police officer. This is the subheading, and this topic can be linked to the syllabus GS1, that is women and related issues. National Crime Records Bureau has revealed that out of a total of 18,099 cases in rape cases, which is decided by various courts in 2017, the state was able to secure conviction in only in 5,822 cases. And this means that a rape accused has 67% chance of acquittal and 32.2% chance of conviction. And in the same year, Delhi secured convictions in 690 rape cases out of total 2,076 rape cases. That means it has got 33.2% conviction rate when it is compared to the 32.2% national average. When the police officer was questioned about the low conviction rate, a senior police official has said that in most of the cases, charge sheet is filed within 60 days, but during the trial, either the witnesses turn unfriendly or hostile, or lack of statement from the eyewitnesses delay the process, thus affects the conviction rate. And it has been found that lack of counseling facilities and support lead to witnesses turning hostile in many cases. And also, delay in investigation and trial also result in less convictions, resulting in less conviction rate, as the victims do not want to pursue protracted litigation. And then a 2013 research paper published in the International Journal of Education and Psychological Research titled An Analytical Study of Rape in Delhi, and it has said that 81% of the victims were from lower socio-economic background, and also it has been said that these groups are very less aware of their fundamental rights. And then there is another article in the page number 8 which reads Long Wait for Justice for Rape Survivors in Kerala, and there are 5,314 cases pending in various courts. This article also is related to rape cases, which talks about pendency of cases and the long wait for the justice. Totally, 305 cases were registered up to 2013 were pending, and it indicates that there is a long wait of the victims for justice in Kerala. Until September, 5,314 rape cases were pending in the state, and with Thiruvananthapuram accounting for the highest number of cases, numbering 1,506. And there are 1,400 cases pending in the session courts and another 106 cases in the magistrate courts of the districts. And it has been noticed that many pending cases could be even older than 6 years. So, in order to avoid this delay in justice, we need to set up a new and exclusive courts for trying rape cases is the only solution. And then, moving on to the answers for the prelims practice question. First question reads, consider the following statements about Accessibility India campaign, also called as Sugamya Bharat Abhiyan. It is a nationwide campaign for achieving universal accessibility for persons with disabilities. Yes, it is the correct statement. And then second statement reads, the campaign has been launched by Department of Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities, which is under Ministry of Social Justice and Employment. Yes, this is also correct statement. So both the given statements are correct. Answer is C, both 1 and 2. Then moving on to the next question, consider the following statements about special category status. The constitution doesn't include any provision for categorization of any state in India, as a special category status. Yes, this is a correct statement. The Constitution has not included any provisions so far. Then the second statement reads, the concept of a social category state was first introduced in 1969 when the Fourth Finance Commission sought to provide certain disadvantaged states with preferential treatment. Statement is wrong because special category status was first introduced in 1969, that is true, but it is the Fifth Finance Commission and not the Fourth Finance Commission. And then, following the constitution of the Niti Aayog and the recommendation of the 14th Finance Commission, the concept of SSC has been done away with. Yes, this statement is correct because 14th Finance Commission has cancelled the special category status given to the states. So, the statements 1 and 3 are correct statements. So, the answer is B, 1 and 3 only. Then moving on to the third question. Consider the following statements about Andhra Pradesh Disha Bill 2019. First statement reads, the bill provides for awarding death sentence for offences of rape and gang rape and expediting the trials of such cases to within 21 days. Yes, this is the correct statement. Then, Andhra Pradesh government will establish, operate and maintain a register in electronic form to be called Women and Children Offenders Registry. Yes, this is also a correct statement. Then the third statement reads, registry will be available to law enforcement agencies only. This statement is wrong because this registry will be made public and will be available to law enforcement agencies. So, this Disha Bill includes the Women and Children Offenders Registry for public also. So, the given third statement is wrong. Answer is 1 and 2 only. Then, moving on to today's prelims practice questions. And the first question is on Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana. And choose the correct statement. And then the second question is on United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Comment your answers in comment box. I'll review it. And then tomorrow we'll discuss these questions. Thank you for watching.